Hello chess friends and welcome to Yazarov chess channel and welcome back to our Queen's Gambit Decline series. So in this series we're following this very nice opening from white's and from black's perspective, and today we're continuing again with our Queen's Gambit Decline series and the so-called Chigorin defense. The Chigorin defense we have explained so far with great sidelines, with great opportunities for both sides, and today we're continuing with a different line in which black is trying sort of a provocative line, in which black is trying to jump a little bit with the knight in the center of the board, is hoping that you will attack the knight and expose yourself. But that's exactly what you should do. In this video I'm going to show you really a nice method how to beat these types of ideas of blacks, because in my opinion this line that we're showing today is not the best of lines here for black. There are different opportunities that we have explained before so far in the series, and if you want to study of course the Chigorin defense more, please check out my previous analyzed games in which we have explained so far the most important strategical and tactical elements of this opening. So today, as said, with a different line, let's check out now what's the difference. And we're starting now with a great game played by two legends of the sport. We're starting now with a great game played by Vasily Ivanchuk against Alexander Morozovich, in which Vasily Ivanchuk will show us basically how to beat these types of ideas. So here d4, d5, we have c4, and now comes the Chigorin move, Chigorin defense move, which is of course the move knight to c6. We have explained so far the main ideas about this move knight to c6. The main goal is of course to get a pawn breakthrough with the move e5 and get a clarification in the center, get the center open, trade off more pieces, go into simplified lines, and really hope for the best. So after move knight to c6, we have recommended so far the move e3 and c takes d5. Also, as I said, as an opportunity, you can play the move knight to c3, and it's also a great line which leads out many times in this continuation. After d takes c4, black is hoping for to get again a simplified line in the center. D takes c4 releases a little bit the pressure in the center, and now again black is hoping for the move e5. So that's why my recommendation here for white is to play the move d5. D5 is creating immediate attack against the knight, and in my previous video we have analyzed this move knight to a4, which was a provocative idea also by black. Black is hoping for that you go into the first queen to a4 and then b4 lines. So in order to get a better understanding of this lines, please check out my previous analyze video. We're not going to analyze this line back. So as I said, this lines we have explained before. So we're continuing now this continuation, knight to e5. Knight to e5 is a more solid way maybe to play the game, but I don't like simply this line because the knight in the center of the board gets simply too much exposed. And here white has to play, I think, the next couple of moves correctly. If white does it, of course, then white is a comfortable game. So here f4. And first of all, what black could try to do is to play this move, knight to d7. There are, of course, opportunities to play knight to g4 or knight to g6. These are the three main ideas. So here we're analyzing first the move knight to d7. Knight to d7 is maybe even the best way here to proceed, because then you want to play here something like knight to b6 and then protect your c4 pawn. But that's exactly what you cannot accomplish, I think, because after move e4 you can play maybe knight to b6. We're playing a4. It's very important now to play this move order like this. After move a4, the idea is clear. We want to play a5, deflecting the knight again from the defense of the pawn, then simply take out the pawn with the bishop and continue now the game with the powerful center, with these three very advanced pawns in the center. Of course, white could have a comfortable game. White would simply push over here in the center. White would simply destroy, I think, black's game in the center of the board. So that's why after move a4, black is pretty much forced to play the move a5. But now after move a5 we have created new weaknesses in the position. So here after move bishop to e3, the main idea now of blacks, the main defensive idea of blacks, is of course to break somewhere a little bit the pawn chain here. Black has to make now a sort of a competition by playing the move c6 or e6. But so far with the move bishop to e3, white is announcing a clarification idea, because here after e6 or c6, whatever you do, we can play of course bishop takes b6. Maybe in some occasions it would be risky to give up the bishop for a knight in an early stage of the game, but not in this scenario, because after c takes b6 we can play bishop to c4 immediately, and I think this is now a decent game, because we should evaluate this position like this. Maybe the pawn count is the same, there are for both sides the same count of pawns on the board, but we shouldn't really evaluate the position like this. What we can notice, this is almost like a 2 versus 2 situation, although these are three pawns versus two pawns on the queen side, but actually black can never really make any progress with the potential b5 move. White can never be challenged here, I think, on the queen side by black's pawns, so that's why I wouldn't even count this as three pawns. These are simply two pawns, because this pawn majority is simply blocked out here also by the bishop's activity on c4, but also the knight is controlling the move b5, so never, but really never, black will have the opportunity to push the pawn and create maybe some kind of a dynamic position on the queen side. So that's why we should notice white is here a dominant position on the king side and also in the center of the board, because we have here a 5 versus 4 pawn majority, so it's much, much better. And the cool part is that the bishop is also controlling here this very important square d5. So here in the continuation, Morozovic tried bishop to b4 to get use of his bishop, because white gave up, of course, the dark square bishop. Now black is trying to attack the squares that the dark square bishop covered. Of course, black is trying to attack the dark squares, but it's not, again, nothing special is going on, because after move knight to f3, even if you try bishop to c3, nothing special is going on, because even if you try to trade, simply a new position will come, but black hasn't improved, I think, in any way the position. In the continuation of the game, white can even fix the pawn structure with the move c4, then build very, very an annoying bishop in the center of the board, supported by these two pawns. And even if you trade in one occasion, maybe knight to f6, then you try here something like knight to d5, then after c takes d5, again we would connect maybe here three pawns in the center, and again white could have the dominant position in the center of the board. So it's not so easy now for black, I think, to play the game. But I see many games in the database in this particular lines. I'm not sure why black is even going into these lines. I'm not seeing good ways here to win the game. Even here d takes e6 is an opportunity for white to simplify the game, simply by trading off the queens, doubling, creating here maybe a weakness on e6, getting here again the use of the pawn majority. So I'm not sure, as I said, why here black is playing the game like this. So in my opinion, nothing special in this opening line. So after move knight to f3, knight to f6, castling, we have now castling, and here finally Vasily Ivanchuk undermines the pressure in the center, plays d takes e6, we have bishop to e6, we have bishop to e6, f takes e6, and now queen to b3. If black wants in any occasion maybe to trade off here the queen, still we can play maybe here an intermezzo, and then go simply here rook takes d1, and I think again white is a comfortable game. So here after move bishop to e6, here f takes e6 was play, queen to b3, we have now king to h8, knight to g5 attacking this pawn, we have knight to g4. Here Morozovic is also trying a counterattack, knight to e6, queen to h4. It was a tricky idea, because after h3 and rook to rook to e8 that Morozovic played, actually you cannot take out here this pawn. That was Morozovic tactical threat, but nothing special. Here after rook to e6, of course queen to e6, then bishop to c5 is winning the game for black. But of course here Vasily Ivanchuk didn't fall for this. After move queen to h4, here h3, rook to e8, and here simply knight to e2. First we have to protect our position in the continuation of the game. Here Morozovic takes, and here after bishop to c5, we have king to h1, h5, rook to d1. Here after rook to d8, rook takes d8, queen to d8, queen to d5. It's obviously a winning game here. Here Morozov tried knight to f2, we have rook to f2, queen takes g5, f takes g5, bishop takes f2, but it's a simplified game in which of course Vasily Ivanchuk has now a pawn majority and has now completely winning endgame. Here after move king to d7, here simply pushing further, and here after move b3 and e7, in this position Alexander Morozovic resigned. So it seems so that it could maybe lead into a stalemate after this one, and maybe you play something like this, then takes, and you see black still has to play some kind of a move because after b6, but still we can always play something like this. Even if you push through here with the move b5, then of course black is going further, but also white is trying to advance simply the pawn and will deliver checkmate. So there's no way that black can force a stalemate position in this setup. So great game by Vasily Ivanchuk, although there were a couple inaccuracies, a couple of mistakes by both sides, but I think the most important thing is to realize what's going on the board because of this. Let's go back, because of this maneuver of the knight, knight to d7, knight to b6, and then to protect the c4 pawn, a4, a5, then bishop to e3, as we said here, simply attacking the key defender of the pawn on c4, then simply take the pawn, rely simply on our pawn majority in the center, going to simplified lines. Even trading off queens is not a bad mistake here for white. I think white has a comfortable game. So even the engine gives here really good advantage for white. So let's check out now another continuation, another possible continuation of these types of structures. We have now great gameplay by Wojciech Muranda against Aleksander Mista. Here we have again this Chigorin defense with the move d5. Here after move knight to e5, again f4, and you can witness now many times this idea, knight to g6. Knight to g6 maybe even slightly better, because now after move e4, of course, maybe in some occasions the f4 could be long-term weakness, but you face many times this continuation. e6 leads now again into a complicated game, I think, for black, but if white doesn't know what to do here, white could also face many problems. Now, what you could make as a mistake is maybe to play here something like bishop to c4 immediately. I don't like this line because it's it is, of course, developing the lines for bishop, but I think black can maybe here simplify the game by simply getting rid of this centralized pawn. What you should do here after e6 is simply take d takes e6 and go into simplified line, because after queen to d1 and king to d1, okay, black has his fun, black traded off the queens, black simplified the game, but the problem is now black has to recapture with the pawn. If black recaptures with the bishop, then you get simply c4 and get the fork, and it's game over. So that's why in this particular line, I've played many times this line against the Chigorin defense, and here after move king to d1, black is, as I said, pretty much forced to play f takes e6, bishop to c4, and relying simply on our better pawn structure. We can notice this e6 is the long-term weakness. It's not so easy to defend this position immediately. Even if e5 happens, then we simply push through with f5, and black is in serious positional problems. So it's not so easy, as I said, for black to play the game. Here in this particular game, a6 was played. All of the PGNs will be in the description below, so maybe you can also check out this analyzed games, analyze them for yourselves. Maybe you're asking some questions about potential sidelines. Also, maybe use the engine and try to search for different strategical and tactical opportunities for both sides. Ever move a6, we have now knight to f3, normal development. I think that white can play many, many moves without making any inaccuracies or mistakes. Here, bishop to b3, here c5. Okay, black has his fun on the queen side, but what black can only do is get some kind of a pawn majority attack. Ever move here b4, bishop to a4 was played, and now knight to e5, you see how white is using now all of the best squares on in the center of the board. We have bishop to b7, knight to g5, we have king to e7, takes. As I said, there are many opportunities, but I think you can notice the pawn structure is much healthier here for white. Even bishop to e3, then maybe put something, rook to c1 is an opportunity. The rooks would be then connected. Let's see now this game. It had really some beautiful tactics in the end. After move rook to d1, king to e7, we have rook to d6, we have bishop to d5, and now a brilliant tactic here by white, rook to d5, because after f5, actually the knight got trapped, and here in the continuation we have knight takes e5, knight takes e5, rook to e8, then now bishop to e3. Here black attacked simply both of these knights. We have a check first, king to f5, and now rook to f1. The rook comes very active into the game. King to g6, knight to f7 attacking the rook, and now again a new check, king to h5, and basically after rook to f3, it's a forced checkmate, because you can maybe try rook to e5, we can take. You can maybe develop the bishop, but now after rook to h3, there's only this idea. You can only cover with the bishop, but now after g4, it's a beautiful checkmate. So really wild stuff. As I said, in this particular scenario, I think here after move knight to g6, e4, after e6, black has to break really the position in one particular moment in the center like this, because if black doesn't do that, then we could advance even the pawn to e5, and these two pawns connected on the fifth rank like this, I think, would be a huge strategical element for white. So that's why here e6 takes, takes takes, and then of course after f takes e6 we're simply relying on this weakness on e6. That's actually the main strategy in this particular line. So let's check out now a new game, it with again with a different continuation. It is a game played by Pavel Tregubov against Evgeny Vorobyov. Here white again, pardon me, black went into the Chigurh in defense. After move knight to c6, we have again this line, knight to c3, d takes c4, we have now d5, and here after knight to e5, f4, again here black tried a different idea. Black tried to retreat with the knight on g4, which is now the most active way. Here after move e4, we can face now again new problems, I think, for black. Again black would love maybe to play the move e6. That's now the huge difference in this line, but e6 is not even a possibility anymore, as you would simply lose the connection between the bishop and the knight. So in this particular scenario, after knight to g4 instead of knight to g6, the problem is that you cannot play the move e6. And here in this game black tried e5, which seems like a normal idea. We want to break at least something. Of course, what you do don't want to do here from white's perspective is to take, then bishop comes out, and I think black has a solid position. Also there is a problem of this game, also the pawn would be protected on c4, so nothing special in this particular line. So white should never, really never simplify the game by trading off now the pawns on e6. Here in this game f5 was played, and f5 is actually even the best move. We can notice now white is a dominant position in the center. White has this advanced pawn on f5, on d5, supported by this very powerful pawn. But there is one problem, which is actually not a problem, I'm not sure how to say it, because it seems so that the white could lose maybe the battle on dark squares, because here after h5, first protecting the knight, knight to f3, and now bishop to c5 could be an opportunity. But actually this is now sort of a trap, because you should not worry in this position. You should simply play bishop to c4, because if you get knight to f2, that's the main maybe tactical problem. You have this one, queen to b3. If you take now knight takes h1, then you get first the check, you can maybe cover, and the problem is now after queen takes c5, the knight doesn't have any more escape plans. Here we can play bishop to e3, king to e2, or queenside castling, and simply take out the knight. The knight will never escape, so we would then get two minor pieces for the rook in this position. I think it's a suicide mission here for black. So that's why after move knight to f2, the game and queen to b3, the game could lead maybe into this line. But now with bishop to g5, we should simply play an active game. Queen to d6 takes takes, and now rook to f1 is solving now all of the position problems. You can play in here knight to g4, we can play knight to d1, and let's go maybe in this particular continuation. I think white is now a solid position. Again, I hope you realized white is really in a better position because of this very powerful space advantage in the center of the board. So as I said, after move bishop to c5, don't worry so much. Knight to f2 is not something special here in the continuation. Bishop to c4, here in the continuation queen to e7, we have queen to b3, knight to f6, again this idea, bishop to g5, we have bishop to f2, again not a problem, because king to e2, the square for the king on e2 is perfectly fine, because you're not vulnerable to your opponent's attacks, as you have this powerful center, and the pawn structure in the center is blocked out. The center can never be open, so your king is perfectly fine on the square. Now we're even threatening something like h3, then if the knight retreats, to take out simply the bishop on f2. So that's why bishop to b6 had to be played. We have h3, bishop to h6, rook to d1, we have bishop to d7, and now d6. This was now a brilliant move here by white, c takes d, and now after knight to d5, we're relying simply on this very powerful pin. Queen to d8, knight to h4, bishop to c6 takes takes, and now bishop to h6, rook to h6, and now bishop to f7. Here after bishop d5, this is now a brilliant move, because we're occupying simply the weak square, the most important square now in the center of the board. We have now occupied the square that's in front of the backward pawn. That's exactly our strategy. When you face the backward pawn, we should block the backward pawn, like this bishop to d5. You see now white has a really nice central grip around the square. Everything is pretty much glued together around the square d5. The rook is controlling that square, the pawn is, the queen is also controlling the square. Now we have to maybe play something like knight to g6, getting the knight active active, then maybe even g4 is an opportunity. And you see now the king is perfectly fine here on e2. So it's a brilliant, brilliant position game here by white. So king to c7 was played, rook to d3, queen to e8, now simply doubling up rooks, getting here the pieces very active. Rook to b1, bishop to d4, knight takes. Here rook to rook to b3, getting this very powerful rook battery on the b file. Rook to b8 takes, takes, and now check. Here a new check, and the rook was lost in this position. Black simply resigned. So, as I said, there are three ways for black how to escape with this knight after a potential f4 move, and after move knight to e5. So after f4, knight to g6, knight to g4, and knight to d7 are opportunities. In my opinion, these are not the best of lines that black can choose in the Chigorin defense. It's something that black should try to avoid. Here is a way, as I said, how to beat these types of ideas in this very, very sharp opening. So, okay, I hope that you enjoyed our analysis, and I hope that you enjoyed this video. If you want to study the Chigorin defense and the Queen's Gambit decline, especially with some other ideas more, check out my whole series with some great games that we have analyzed before. Here's the link of our series so far. And if you have trouble maybe to play as black, check out my commented chess games in hyper accelerated ranked Sicilian defense, and also in our Nimzo Indian defense, as good responses to d4 and e4. And if you like this content, don't forget to subscribe to my channel. See you soon with some more videos, and chess is the best, of course.